Hi everyone, thank you for listening. My name is Laura Koetzle and I am the VP and Group Director for Security and Risk Research at Forrester. And this session is 5 ways to drive revenue by protecting customer privacy. So this is an era of amazing innovation, as all of us know, and I'm just going to give 2 examples here. The fact that I can handwrite notes and use Evernote to share them with whoever I want, wherever they want to be, is hugely beneficial. And shopping carts that sync with my grocery list and my family's grocery list are fantastic. And if you want to show me a couple of targeted ads while you're at it, great. So these things make our lives more convenient, but in consumer world, the downsides of this level of availability of information are now very widely known and fairly well understood, at least at the impact on the public level. And that's beginning to make a difference in how our customers behave. So I live in Amsterdam, as you'll see from my strangely formatted phone number at the end, and this is particularly prevalent in Europe, where you get lots of consumers actively seeking to enforce their privacy rights. So you see a bunch of numbers with lots of zeros on the screen here. Just to give one of these examples, in that 25,000 people who are seeking to join the class action lawsuit, the potential is for each of those members of the class to result in a fine for Facebook in Austria, I think, of 500 euros a person, which very quickly turns into real money when it's this number of people, even if you're Facebook. So the world is changing, where consumers used to very happily give you their passwords to all of their corporate resources in exchange for pens when standing in one of the stations in London. They won't do that quite so much anymore. And so my contention here is that over the next 5 years, consumer sophistication and commitment to privacy will continue to grow. And they're going to continue, they've already started, mind you, to vote with their wallets. If they don't think that companies are doing a good enough job of protecting their personal information and being transparent about how they're using it, they will leave because they have plenty of other choices. And the result of that will be that companies that can monetize their customer data with customer consent will thrive. And companies that can't will stagnate, and the ones that do a really terrible job will over time disappear. Now, this sounds really strange to a lot of us who come from the security business, thinking, but of course people want to protect their privacy. How can this possibly be a way to make more money? Isn't it just something we have to do to avoid fines? So you're probably feeling slightly skeptical. The way you want to think about this is that this is a consumer-led shift. A really good analogy that's going to seem strange at first, but bear with me, is the organic food movement. So think back, say 30, 40 years. Some of you probably aren't old enough to think back that far, but you know, extrapolate. And back then, no one cared how their food was produced, how the animals were treated, what kind of pesticides the people who were growing them were using, outside of a few places like Berkeley, California, just across the bridge from where the conference will be, and Cambridge, Massachusetts, where I used to live. Nowadays, however, companies like this one are billions and billions of dollars in revenue and in market capitalization because people care about where their food comes from and how it's treated. So think of consumers changing attitudes to privacy as very much like the organic food movement, something that's going to grow over time and is going to transform how consumers relate to various markets. So here's one easy way to think about this, which is that thinking about privacy, if you do a good job, you're going to engender greater trust in your customers, and that will let you win, serve, and retain more of them. So how do you do that? And this is where all of us in the security field and the privacy field need to help our colleagues in places like marketing and sales and customer service think about privacy the right way so that good intentions and wanting to sell more product for the company don't turn into customer privacy failures and intrusions and reductions of trust. And the way to think about that is what we call contextual privacy. Contextual privacy is a business practice where all collection and use of personal data is consensual within a mutually agreed upon context for a mutually agreed upon purpose. I'm reading the definition out not just to bore you by reading the words on the slide, but because the mutually agreed upon consensual the consensual nature of this is critical. The ideal state is one in which any data that your company collects, the consumers understand why you're collecting it, what you're going to do with it. They're confident that if any of those things change, that you will ask them first in some useful way, and that you're going to give them some benefit out of sharing this data with them that they will understand and recognize, rather than it being a stealthy practice that helps your marketing efforts and gives them nothing in return. So there are five ways to do this, as in the title of the talk, and I'll talk about each of them in short form here. So the first is to use privacy to attract more customers. A good example of this has been the not just the most recent launch of iOS 9, but also the launch of iOS 8. So Apple here does a very good job of upping the game on consumer-facing privacy by giving you notifications like this one, where telling you what applications has been using, what kind of information in the background, and giving you a chance to say, yes, I want to do this, or no, I don't want to do this anymore. And they've also added an ad blocking feature in iOS 9 that will be very important for marketers going forward. The second way that you can make more money with privacy is to aggregate data and offer more personalized services. All of us use services like this, particularly those of us who would be listening to an RSA conference webcast. And two good examples are the ones here on the slide. For companies like TripIt and Mint, your personal data is really their only asset. They're taking that data and using it to offer you services that you will then choose to pay for, choose to use more of, choose to connect with other third-party services. Their whole business is based around you offering them your data to get something that you value as a consumer. And so businesses like that, if they lose the trust of the consumers that have given them this personal data, they effectively have no business going forward. So they're incented to not only protect their ability to offer more personalized services, but to keep themselves in business at all. So the third way to make more money with privacy is to charge a premium for privacy-enhanced services. There are plenty of examples of this out there because consumers have gotten quite used to freemium service models where there's the free version and then there's the more powerful version that you have to pay some usually fairly small amount of money for. One example of this in the privacy space is Google Contributor. And so what this gives you the ability to do is to contribute towards the companies and causes and publishers that you like, as opposed to, hey, I'm just going to get shown a bunch of ads and a bunch of people are going to make some very small amounts of money as a result of that. The fourth way that you can make more money with privacy is by monetizing the data that you have. And so this is for the large consumer data houses that sell data to people to do everything from give you a credit score and figure out whether you should get a mortgage and all of that kind of stuff to what kind of direct mail to send you to fill up your mailbox, like Axiom, through to personal data aggregators like Ezeco. So these folks are going to figure out how to take the data that they collect from consumers with consent, mind you, that's transparent, and monetize that in the way that they sell it back to other companies to do new things. Now, of course, it's very easy as a consumer to hear this and say, but I don't want you to sell my data to anyone. But of course, if we want these personalized services and we give our consent explicitly to have them, then the monetization of data is actually a good thing that's consensual as opposed to something strange and creepy that happens in the background. And then the fifth way to make more money with privacy is to productize privacy explicitly itself. And there are lots of examples of this. Something like AVG's Privacy Fix you're probably familiar with, which is a privacy dashboard that you can use across all of your devices and settings to make sure that as a consumer, you're only revealing the things about yourself that you want to be revealing in the context where you want to be revealing them. Another one that I quite like is JotForm, because software as a service company that allows you with one click of a button to say, please store all of my data in the European Union, which for those of us who worry about data residency requirements is a genuinely very good and useful thing. Now we've got the US EU privacy shield to replace the defunct safe harbor, so data residency is less absolutely required in some instances than in others, but you're still going to need to think about it a lot, and easy tools that help you do that are a really good thing, both for consumers and for companies. So the thing I want to leave you with here is that this approach, which we call contextual privacy, gives you the ability to do two things at once, to have your cake and eat it too, as it were. It reduces your risk, and it helps you drive more revenue and make more money with these five different approaches to privacy. So I'm Laura Koetzle, as I said, and here is my contact information. I look very much forward to hearing from any of you who are interested. For those who are coming along to RSA Conference North America, I will also talk further about all the implications of this approach to privacy in the future, as well as the potential intermediators of these kinds of privacy services that we'll see and that our companies are going to have to figure out how to interact with.